chaired by Marilyn and Marilyn Peters.
Thank you.
Please give them a round of
applause. Thank you. Thank you.
Marilyn's member has a textile background, which she can talk all about, and then it's her husband, and together they have done great things with the loom, and I'm really looking forward to it. So I'll turn it over to you two now.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the lovely introduction. Is that on?
Yeah, close to you.
Oh, that's okay. Yeah. Thank you very much for the lovely introduction, Margie. Yes, we're here today to talk to you about our Hattersley Loom, the adventure and the restoration. Yeah, it's been a very interesting 18 months.
Our journey, and mine in particular, has been from knowing nothing 18 months ago about weaving. It's been the steepest learning curve that I've ever had, and Marilyn's been on the journey as well. So it's and you'll see as the slides progress actually what we got up to. But from Linda's farm and watching the sheep get shorn and all the way through to Marilyn washing fleece, combing yarn and then spinning it, and what we're doing today, which is producing a fabric. So, you know, it's been a massive learning curve, but I have enjoyed it. I tend to do a little bit of the manual labour on the loom, so I actually quite enjoy that. Compared to my day job, it's very satisfying, and it's a really enjoyable way to spend the time. So, luckily, Marilyn has some background.
Yeah, so my background is, well, I started sewing on my mum's sewing machine when I was 6 years old, and naturally I went on to learn how to do design and dressmaking and one-off bridal gowns. And I also worked as a clothing designer for about 11 years with Bushwalking Company, and also went on to do some training as a colour and style consultant.
And my background is very varied and different, but I'm a fitter and turner by trade, so these are my hobbies. I restore old vehicles. My old Land Rover, I restored every nut and bolt from the ground up, and the 1942 Blitz truck is my current project, just completing that for the local fire brigade. I'm moving now on to pre-war motorcycles, so from 1900 to 1940, so I'm on the lookout for some old motorbikes. So the Hattersley, yet just another mechanical project, but I've really enjoyed it.
So really my introduction to weaving that wasn't dressmaking cloth, and not the theory of weaving, was in January 2018 with Andrew McCracken's introductory weaving course at the Guild Summer School, which was fabulous. And here I learnt to weave and got the basic understanding of how to weave and the colours and all that kind of stuff. So yeah. We attended Liz Cowland's exhibition at Palm House. I dragged Nathan along into the city with me, and I was really inspired. After being inspired by the Guild's workshop, it was fantastic to see how far we can push it as weavers. And so it was beautiful to see all the beautiful weaving patterns and all the colours.
And I went along for the ride. I didn't know what to expect, and Liz's work is obviously wonderful, but I was just talking to Liz and asking about whether she knew of any of these old weaving machines, if they still existed, and whether or not that there were any available in Australia. And so we got talking, and Liz mentioned the name Hattersley, and I'd never heard of that. And she also said she had a few names in the industry, but it was very unlikely that we're ever going to turn up an old machine in this day and age. Most of them ended up in the scrap heap. So we didn't leave dejected, but we didn't think we'd find anything in a hurry. So we got home, and as you do, you start getting on Google and doing the internet research, and I looked up Hattersley, and I found out a lot about it. And like I said, my learning curve's been very steep, but I found out that the Hattersley family's really started making looms back in the Industrial Revolution. So they, from the transition from the wooden looms to the iron, and then with the advent of the steam engine, they started mass producing textiles, and Hattersley was at the forefront of these industrial machines. He made literally dozens of different types for dozens of different fabrics, from silks to cottons to wool and everything in between. So that's an example of the early textile mills, and the steam driven, you can see the shafts up the top with the pulley systems. So there may have only been one person in charge of six looms, but there would have been people everywhere, obviously, in a massive process. But this was in England. George Hattersley was English, in the north of England, where a lot of the textiles were created. But, I mean, the revolution also happened throughout America, and there's different types of machines. The design's very, very similar, and even in Japan, they were using very similar design machines. Interestingly, the type of machine with the picking sticks, we'll see it later on, was that same design, as beautiful as that design is, was kept manufacturing up until the 1980s. They used the same technology, so they did it right first time. So at about 1900, Hattersley decided to make looms for the domestic market. Similar to the treadle sewing machines, he wanted to make a treadle loom, and he created a loom, and he was spruiking it as 160 picks per minute and using 2-to-8 shafts. So again, it's pedal operated, so it's still actually classed as hand weaving. And if we look at Harris Tweed and any of the people that are still weaving in the Outer Hebrides, in Lewis Island and Harris Island, still up until today, Harris Tweed is under license, very strictly strictly managed on those islands. But these people, that's just where we're talking about, Harris and Lewis, up in that northern section of Scotland. And that's the type of gentleman that was working these machines, and they still are today, the crofters. So they had sheep, and it's believe that they make up to 75 metres in a week on these machines. I can attest to the speed of these machines. It's the setup. The setup is actually the difficult part, but once you get rolling, so 75 metres a week, and you can see the warp there. There's a fair bit to produce. It was also mentioned that the design and the domestication of these looms was handy for a return servicemen with various injuries as well, so they could make a living in these on their farms in the sheds. So interestingly, this whole domestic weaving system that George Hattersley created, they were assembled in the factory in Keighley, near Bradford in Yorkshire, and they weigh half a tonne, so they're quite heavy machines. But they built them and painted them in the factory, and painted little numbers to correspond in each part. So there's probably nearly 1,000 moving parts in these machines. They then pulled them down and flat packed them, similar to IKEA. And ship them around the world. And I have to point out to you that this is the user guide that came with it.
Sorry.
4 pages in quite large print, and 2 of those pages are actually pictures on how to tune it. So this is what we had to go on, basically, those 2 pages. And that's how to assemble that machine from nuts and bolts. So It's a real insight into the ingenuity of these people, and how clever they were to be able to organise these machines. And the Hattersley domestic weaving system, as you'll see, so that's the basic Mark I loom, but you also needed this warping mill as well as part of the package, and the pern winder. So that all these machines together speed up the process.
So back to our journey. 3 weeks later, after seeing Liz at her exhibition, I got a call, and she said that she knew of somebody who wanted to rehome their Hattersley Loom. And it was down at Tathra. It was about 6 hours drive away. And we didn't have long to get it, as it turns out.
No, they lost their home in the Tathra bushfires. And they also, only the shed survived, so it was really unfortunate that they had lost their house, but they'd had this in the shed for 20 years. They'd had plans to do something with it and hadn't. So we only had a week to pick it up. So that sort of, from going to maybe we'll never find one, to finding one and then having a week to do something about it was good fun. But enter our next door neighbour, Chris. Yeah. He had he's a man with many, many skills and tools.
And a heart of gold.
Yeah, heart of gold and a truck. So Chris and I jumped in the truck and decided to do a road trip down to Tathra. And 6 hours later, Marilyn got a phone call.
Yeah, I got a call and he said to me, I've got this really rough made countermarch loom you can have. You can cut it up for firewood if you don't like it, and I don't care, just as long as you kind of get it out here. And naturally, knowing the circumstances, we said we'd love to have it if it fits on the truck. So we got it home and we put it all back together. It wasn't quite complete, and I'm very lucky to have a friend nearby, Yvonne Cattell, who was able to give me advice on how to fix the back brake of the hand loom. And again, it makes really lovely rugs.
Yeah, it certainly does. And Marilyn's second attempt on the rug loom got her a third prize at the Royal Easter Show this year, so.
That's a little bit embarrassing.
The loom has, it's handmade from fence posts. It's Even the advanced gear is made out of an old bit of pipework that's been hand cut. The gears have been hand cut with a hacksaw. It's a beautiful, beautiful piece of furniture, let alone a working machine. So that was a nice little bonus. So we needed a truck with a crane to also get it onto our truck. On sloping ground, it was quite an adventure. But Chris and I got it on the truck. Another 6 hour drive. We ended up doing about a 15 hour day. And here's Chris with his multitude of different tools. He's got a forklift as well. So when we got it home, we were able to get it into a garage. And that's really where the journey of restoration begins.
So question, where or how do you start a restoration when your instruction sheets are 4 pages long and your parts catalogue is 4 pages long?
Yeah, we take lots of photos, that's the answer. So Marilyn took hundreds of photos from every angle of different parts. As I said, the little numbering system was great, but we did intend to do a full restoration, which meant stripping those numbers off, unfortunately. So the best thing about a restoration, in my experience, is to actually get it working to some form before you actually strip it down, so that you at least know that it worked once and you can get it back to that that level.
I've got a new skill. I know how to sandblast. As Nathan put all every little nut and bolt off, put them in a pile, and I just dutifully went on and sandblasted in that box all 100 years of grime off them. Yeah, each little piece.
So again, I can't tell you how impressed I am with the design of this machine and the engineering, but it's sand cast, so it's all cast iron. There's no roller bearings or modern bearings. It's all metal on metal. There's no bronze. We stripped it down to the bare cast metal, and we were a bit dubious about how to find the original colour. I'm a bit of a stickler. When I restore something, I want to get it to that level. But 100 years of grime and dirt and oil, it was hard to work out what the colour was.
So we eventually opened the picking sticks cap and up came this beautiful green colour. So I swanned on down to the local auto paint shop and got them to colour match and formulate this colour and got them to pop it into spray cans for us.
Yeah, and the pressure pack spray cans make the restoration a lot easier, just down to the fact that you can do small groups and it doesn't become overwhelming, so you don't have 1,000 parts to paint all at once. So the pressure pack cans were really handy, and we had everything from bare metal to primer and then to an automotive enamel paint. So on the process went, every single nut and bolt was hand cleaned prior to painting. The timber, there's a small bit of timber work on there, we polished up the timber work. So you can see just slowly skeletonising the machine. It works off a main crankshaft and a gearbox, which gives you a shaft lifting pattern. The weavers among you will understand, all these terms are new to me and I'm learning very fast, but this is the camshaft and the cam lobes which lift the shaft. So there's 8 of them here. We've only got a 4 shaft loom, but it could be converted to an 8. And you'll see a lot of the people that are using these Hattersleys throughout the world have one of these already set up separate so they can just lift it out of the gearbox and put a new one in with the different lobes. That's just a small array of the different cam lobes for those lifting patterns. I can't even imagine what those patterns would produce or where you would go about finding those around the world now. They've probably all gone to scrap, but it would be great to have that array and that choice.
So the disassembly and cleaning still went on. We should have bought shares in WD-40.
Yeah, lots of elbow grease and sandpaper for the restoration.
So after Nathan painted it the beautiful green colour, I went on and dutifully pinstriped or did all the gold trimming detail on it. That's my kind of thing, not really Nathan's.
I don't have the patience. So once Marilyn had done all the trimming and we'd got all the completed parts, we brought it all inside. It needed to be put up on a timber stand, so I just got an old fence post and cleaned and planed the fence post down, so we had a base for it. And then the jigsaw puzzle began, putting it back together. Luckily we've got the room, we had a spare room, so these machines, they use machine oil, and so you can imagine the factory or the workshops, they just squirt oil around it every day before they started, and the mess and all the fibres caught in that, it just creates such a mess. So I did move into the 21st century and bought lithium grease in a spray can, which actually holds fast, doesn't melt, doesn't throw. So we've been producing in our lounge room with very little mess. It's really the fibres that are the bigger mess. So touch wood, no problem so far. Down at Tathra, it sat in that shed, but it was right on the water, so we had salt water issues and rust, but the leather, obviously, it was perished, didn't last long, and we just spoke to a saddle maker to get some new leather. They had some different sizing, and those picking straps do probably one of the hardest jobs on the loom.
Yeah, I washed and bleached the front cloth beam and had to replace the tie-ins.
Yeah, everything was pretty dusty. So that's the completed unit, and you'd probably agree, as a piece of furniture, it's actually quite beautiful. It's I do rave on and on about the engineering, but even all these gears on this front section, that's just there to advance the beam. You know, it too fast and it's too tight a weave and too slow and it's too open. And yeah, there's so many things that have to happen to time it. I've timed truck engines that were easier to time than this machine.
So this is our first test sample. You'll notice it's actually quite narrow compared to the front beam. And also I couldn't use the temples there. You'll see that it draws in a bit. We're also pulling it through what we thought was a clean reed, even though it was the original one, we did clean it, but it wasn't clean enough because if you look at our front at the beginning of the weaving here, it's actually still a little bit rusty and orange.
And yeah, so there's a nice colour change throughout that one. But yeah, more elbow grease and a few little tricks got the reed clean eventually.
You'll also notice there that this 2x2 twill, which should have a like 45 degree angle on the twill, it's a little bit tighter than that. So, yes, we needed to learn how to tune.
Yeah, but it was a joy to have it work the first time somewhat. The only thing we were missing really was the shuttles and perns. They're obviously expendable, and you can see we got two original shuttles here that were almost paper thin and worn. I had no idea that that's quite worn compared to an original. So there is a huge network around the world.
Yeah, I joined a Facebook group of Hattersley weavers, and I'm very grateful that they accepted me, but I got information from them to find out where to get new shuttles, new perns, and which is in the UK, and the perns there are actually new, old stock, so they're original, so that's cool.
Yeah, and these boat shuttles are, and again, something I learned. Have you ever heard of the kissing shuttle? Is everyone aware of it? You see the little ceramic hole here? So the weavers would, you'd need to put your lips to it to suck the thread through, which I'm pretty sure probably killed a lot of weavers over the years, just fibres in the lungs and that sort of stuff, I dare say. So then Pilkington's in England, so these are for the Hattersley Loom, the Mark I. They're beautifully made, very heavy. You can have a feel of this later. And the bullet points here, one of those in the temple and you wouldn't last long. They break windows, break limbs, I think. But you can see there is no ceramic hole. It's just got a slot there, makes it easier to load that yarn in, and a little spring there, which makes my job a lot easier. And the perns, as Maz said, were new old stock, but the pern winding machine, which we don't have, and we had a little video here.
Earlier this week in my local spinning and weaving group, I was given by the lovely Ellen a couple of bunches just there, as you see, of some heddles. As I was cleaning them before we put got everything rolling. I did break some and some were broken, they'd rusted through. And now as we've continued to weave, some of them broken. But yes, I was so grateful to receive some heddles from Ellen, and we've just worked out that some of the bunches will actually fit the machine. It's a really unusual width or length heddle, and so we're really grateful for those. Thank you, Ellen.
Yeah, it's been amazing how many people have helped us out, just finding bits and pieces. And again, Liz found a book for us in her library, in Modern Looms, it's called, from 1925, I think, and there's 1915 machinery accessories there. And again, these machines, they had a machine type for every type of yarn, like I said before, silks and toweling and different.
Yeah, I noticed two particular looms. There was a loom for cotton sheeting and a loom for linen sheeting. So that's how specific they got.
Yeah, and the book that Liz gave us, there was just one page in there that was critical to the way that I set up the shuttle boxes. It just had a couple of hints on angles and throw, and that changed the way we did things. So it's amazing what you'll find in these old documents that doesn't get passed on. So I was really grateful for that. And again, another part, we're missing the warping mill.
I'm using a warping mill from Helen Halpin, so that's lovely.
We had some slow motion footage of us warping.
Well, actually, time lapse.
Oh, time lapse, yeah. I'll just talk about the revolving box. So our and the punch card, whatever you want to call it, world's earliest computer, that sort of thing. It's a pattern card that allows that revolver, which has six shots in it, so you can put six different colours and your pattern card, and it will pick. Again, based on the it runs like clockwork, but at the moment we are struggling to find any of the pattern cards, so we will have to make them ourselves. And those can run into meters in length depending on your pattern. So that's our next step in the process, is actually getting the revolving box working, so we can get. And again, it makes that process a lot quicker. Doing 5 metre lengths or 5 metres in total, Rich will get. And really, that's a day's work. And when I say a day's work, that's the machine. It does take me a couple because I'm not that. If I was doing an 8-hour day and I was chained to it, I could easily do that in a day. But it's the setting up, it's the warping, it's the design. It's Maz does does a lot more work than I do. And we missed the bit about the not having a pern winder. That's one of the hardest things to keep up the amount of perns. A full pern in one of these will only do 60 to 80 picks. So I can do that in 60 seconds or 30 seconds, but Marilyn has set up.
I am a pern winder. I've set up my spinning wheel with a stylus, and so I slide the pern over the stylus and I spin my little perns. So that's. Pardon? Okay, that's a great idea. Thanks, Prue.
Well, these perm winders, again, I talk about the engineering, but you can have 3 to 6 perns, and a lot of people now put electric motors on those instead of the pedals, but you can walk away from it, you can leave your cones, and it'll wind the perns to an exact size, and I've never seen anything modern that does the same thing as these old machines. It'll wind the pern exactly the same every time, and it'll spit them out when it's done. And again, I don't know why that engineering doesn't exist today, because of all the electric pern winders that I've seen, the benchtop ones, you still have to stand there and feed it generally. There's nothing that'll actually feed it for you, which is remarkable. They do exist, the pern winders.
So this is another fabric that I've made, just with grey. And one thing I should mention about the yarn that we're using, it's The yarn that we're using is actually 2-ply knitting wool at the moment, so I know it's technically probably not the correct yarn to be using, but I guess we're still learning and just having a bit of fun at the moment. But I definitely want to use more wool. I know that from a dressmaking perspective that it's so forgiving and great for, I guess, beginner weavers, and it's just a beautiful product. So this is one of the blankets that we've made, little blankets. Thank you. Yeah, sure. And this is just another piece of fabric that I was going to turn into a pashmina or scarves. And my ladies at the local spinning group in Springwood just are horrified when I mention I'm going to cut into my weaving, but I say, what the heck?
You know what you're doing.
Well, there may be that. And after the cream weaving that we did, which was kind of the first bit of weaving, I decided to do this. Thanks, Margie, I really appreciate that. So, thank you. This will turn into a few scarves for my brother and his 3 nephews.
Yeah, it's very hands-on at the moment until we start getting these pattern cards and progressing.
Yeah.
Any questions?
Yeah.
How long does it take? How long does it take you to the whole process? Cleaning and restoration? Can you repeat the question?
Oh, so how long did it take to restore the machine? Probably, when did we finish it?
It was about 4 or 5 months, I think. It was actually remarkably quick for me.
I think with Nathan on the job though, Nathan is remarkably driven and always out in the shed. I don't know what that says about me.
No, it was, yes? The process, and just wanting to finish it and actually, you know, see if it worked. Was dr- through on driving or something. So yeah, it was quick. But I mean, from all this, I would love to see us get the Pern winder and the warping mill. They do exist. We've seen them, but they turn up in the UK rarely, and to get one shipped would be hugely expensive. So we're hoping with the network that exists that we might be able to find some more of these machines, and you know, we'd love to continue and make more and make you know, and try and sell some items. And
yeah, one day.
The Harris, well, even those who aren't producing Harris Tweed, they're just producing, they still sell to clothing designers and tailors, so you could just make the fabric for someone else to actually make the clothing, so that'd be great.
Do we have any other questions? Yeah.
Do you know the history of the machine and how it came to be in Tarthra, how it came to be in Australia?
Do we know how the history of our machine and how it came to be in Tarthra?
Melbourne.
It came via Melbourne.
It was in a factory in Melbourne, and it then went to Tarthra, and they had every intention of getting it. They did get it working briefly,
yes.
But it never got to completion. But it sat in their shed for 20 years, I think in the early 80s, perhaps it was given up for Melbourne. But yeah, somewhere, some factory in Melbourne.
Any other questions? How?
Yes, we've just got a little fringe all the way around.
Yeah, I was just going to leave it. It's zigzagged multiple times around, so I think the machine thread should hold it, yeah.
Thank you both so much. What a fascinating talk. But if you haven't got the hang of watching again, it's really well worthwhile because you get to see and hear very clearly everything that is said, which is marvellous. And last month, Liz Williamson had so much information that I needed to watch it again and again to learn little bits. So it would be really good to be able to go through and see the slow motion of the loom. I think that's been fascinating. Thank you both very, very much. And I can see you teaching us, Marilyn, about creating fabric for dressmaking in the future. And
perhaps
we can draw a name and closer into this community of ours. That would be wonderful.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.